Amen. Amen.
Brother, I want to play that song one more time, please. Hallelujah.
King is in love. We lost the time.
before your throne of grace in the mighty name of Jesus, Lord. We thank you, Lord, that we have access, Lord. We thank you, Lord, for the light of the world, Lord God, that gives us direction in the midst of darkness, Lord God. We just thank you, Lord God, for this night, Lord God, to come and hear a word from you, Lord God. I pray, Lord God, that you would set me apart, Lord God. That you would use me, Lord God, as an instrument, Lord God, to edify the church, Lord God. To bring a word into season, Lord God. To give understanding, Lord God. To give wisdom, Lord God. To give peace, Lord God. To saturate their hearts with your love, my God. Use us all in a mighty way, Lord God, to become the church that you've created us to be, Lord God. We thank you, Lord God, in advance for all that you're doing in this ministry, Lord God. I pray that you would continue to raise us up, Lord God, to give us faith and courage, Lord God, to build this kingdom, Lord God, upon your foundation, Lord God. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. We're going to go ahead and let the kids go off the class. I just want to pray before because they never get to hear us pray before they go. Amen. Hallelujah. Well, we're going to continue the series, the mystery of the tabernacle. And today we're going to be talking about the lampstand. But before we get into the teaching, I just want to just touch base on a lot of what we've been teaching in here, because I know a lot of people haven't been here through everything. So basically, we're talking about the tabernacle and all of the furnishings inside the tabernacle. And each and every single one of them have different representations. They're all symbolic, and they all foreshadow things to come in the church, things to come in the future, and things to come as a whole, as a body. And today we're going to be talking about the menorah, which is the lampstand, and the lampstand is such a significant part of the tabernacle. Because without it, there would be no light. There would be darkness, and we wouldn't be able to see the glory of God. And how many of you know Jesus is the light of the world? He is the lampstand. Jesus represents the center of this menorah right here, and these are all branches. Branches that come out of this menorah that represent seven churches. It represents seven spirits. It represents so many other things as far as the Holy Spirit, the oil. There's so many things that we're going to learn of today. But before we get into that, I just want to touch base on some scripture out of the New Testament before we read out of the Old Testament, just to give you some reference to give you some foundation, all right? So it says, but now in Christ Jesus, we're going to be reading out of Ephesians 2, and it's going to be 13 through. It says, but now in Christ Jesus, you who once were far off have been brought near by the blood of Christ. For he himself is our peace, who has made both one and has broken down the middle wall of separation, having abolished in his flesh the enmity that is the law of commandments contained in ordinances, so as to create in himself one new man from the two, thus making peace, and that he might reconcile them both to God in one body through the cross, thereby putting to death the enmity. And he came and preached peace to you who were afar off and to those who were near. For through him we both have access by one Spirit to the Father. Now therefore you are no longer strangers and foreigners, but fellow citizens with the saints and members of the household of God, having been built on the foundation of the apostles and prophets, Jesus himself being the chief cornerstone, in whom the whole building being fitted together grows into a holy temple in the Lord, in whom you also are being built together for a dwelling place of God in the Spirit. Amen. Can anybody say amen? Amen? The dwelling place of God. The whole thing of the tabernacle, tabernacle means mishkan. And mishkan in Hebrew means to dwell with. God wants to dwell with us, church. God wants us to be set up to where we're in order, to where we have the lampstand, to where we have the brazen altar, to we have the wash basin, the table of showbread, and the altar of incense. And we have to have all of them. It's what we call the fivefold ministry. as Christians. Back in the day, this is how they did it in the tabernacle. But now we have a fivefold ministry, which we have the teachers, we have the preachers, we have the prophets, the evangelists, and the apostles. There you go. And in order for us to operate in the spirit, we have to be in order. Things have to be in order in the church. So what God is trying to teach us is how to be in order. In the Old Testament, you have the, can you put up that picture? You have the tabernacle, and then you have the courtyard. Outside of the courtyard, you would have, as soon as you walk in to the courtyard, you would have the altar, the sacrificial altar, and then you would have the wash basin. Okay, so when you would come in, you would have to offer your sacrifices, and then you would have to wash. And then after you wash, you were allowed to enter into the holy place, where you would come and you would see the menorah inside, you would see the table of showbread, and then the altar of incense. And everything was in order the way it should have been, in order for you to prepare yourselves to enter into the Holy of Holies, to access God Himself. Amen? And how many of you know that Jesus made that happen for us? He gave us that access. When He died on the cross, it says that the veil was rent. Therefore, that it was cut, and that we didn't have to, fulfill the law ourselves. We didn't have to go through the whole time. We didn't have to be holier than thou in order to have access to God. Now we have a mediator, which is Christ Jesus, our Lord and Savior. And right now, Jesus is trying to reveal Himself through the tabernacle. Because everything about the tabernacle and the temple back then was a foreshadow of Christ Himself, being the chief cornerstone, is what it said. He was the chief cornerstone, and the foundation was His blood. Do you remember the silver? The foundation was His blood. Because without the foundation, without the blood, there was no remission of sins. Amen? So we have to kind of pay attention to everything that's going on in order to get a better understanding. So before we go in, I just want to refresh everybody on what we were talking about. So we had the two offerings is what Pastor started on. And does anybody know what those two offerings were? And the half shekel, amen. The half shekel, do you know what that? The half shekel, it was the atonement, right? But it also represents our faith, because it says it's by faith and faith alone, right? We're saved by grace, right? So it also represents our faith. So we cannot receive salvation without faith. We have to believe that Jesus is the Son of God. We have to believe He died on the cross for our sins, and that He rose from the grave on the third day, right? So that's the process of it. And then we had the free will offering, which was based on our own free will. How far do you want to go with God? You remember? It was about sanctification, about offering the free will to get closer to God. It just depends on how far you want to go. You know, everybody is comfortable with being saved. They don't want to get involved. They're good where they're at, and they think they can have a personal relationship with God, which is true. You can have a personal relationship, but you cannot get closer to God without the church. You cannot get closer to God without the church. You cannot be used by God without the church, without being in order and doing things the way He wants things to be done. Amen? And then we had the foundation and the walls, which, does anybody remember what the foundation and the walls were? I just said it, the foundation. The foundation was made of silver, but the foundation represented the blood of Jesus, which was the remission of our sins, right? And then you had the walls, the gold walls, but they were gold walls overlaid with wood, right? And the wood represented who? The church, us. It was us. We were the ones, because we were the pillars. The walls represented us as the church. Remember? And then it was up to you. So it's up to us on how far we're willing to go with God. It's up to us on how much you want to be sanctified. It's up to us how much you want to be blessed and be used by God. It's up to us. God's not going to press Himself on anyone. He's not going to force us to do anything that we don't want to do. Amen. Amen? But I guarantee you, we're never going to be able to outdo God. We're never going to be able to give more than what He's going to give in return. Amen? Because He wants to have a divine relationship with us. And in order to have a divine relationship with God, God is a holy God. He is so pure and so divine that He can have nothing to do with sin. So it's the only way we can be purified is to cleanse ourselves. It was like Brother said when he was doing the wash basin. We live our day to day and we struggle when we're out there in the world. The first thing in the morning, we're in traffic. We get a bad start to our day, and then something doesn't go right at work, and then everything else just crumbles from there. And then we're throwing out F-bombs and flipping people off, and it's ungodly. Amen? But that's the flesh. That's the things, the small things that we struggle with are the things that we got to get under control. Because those small things can turn into big things. It is. Because a lot of people, when they start doing little small things, they're just like, I don't know, I can't get it right. I mean, I've already sinned. I might as well just be called a sinner and throw in the towel. Because we think we make one mistake and we're done for. But that's not the God we serve, church. God is gracious. God's grace is sufficient for all of us. We got to get back up. But we got to learn from those mistakes. And we got to, next time somebody cuts us off, just ignore them or give them a high five or just turn your music up a little louder and don't even pay attention to them. And when things don't go right for you during the day or the way you want them to go, or when somebody's, you know, antagonizing you or just trying to get under your skin on purpose, you know that that's not of God, that that's of the devil. He's pushing your buttons. He knows how to get through to you. He knows how to get a rise out of you. Amen? So we can't allow that to happen. We have to be the light of the world. And that's what this is all about, this lampstand. These branches represent seven different churches. Amen? But it also represents us, because in the Bible it says that we were grafted in, right? And when we were grafted in, it talks about an olive branch. This menorah also represents a tree. And it's the olive tree. The only thing that can be put into this these bowls up here was olive oil, pure olive oil. And these lights burned forever. It was up to the priest to go into the holies to fill this up on a daily. And this thing right here, I ordered this off of Timo. I tried to get the one like Brother, the big cross. It was supposed to be like 7 feet tall. But on Timo, this is how it came. But just to give you a perspective of what it looks like, put it up on the other one, Brother. This is the true menorah right here, made of solid gold. 90 pounds of solid gold. And you know gold represents purity. So the purity is divine. There is nothing human about this. There's no representation of human in this, because this is purely God, with Jesus in the center and the branches of the seven churches and the seven spirits. Amen? And it continually burned all day, every day. There was not one time that this didn't burn. And even when the temples weren't up, even when they were taken hostage by, it was burning somewhere else, in somebody else's house, or under guard, where people didn't know it. But this light has never burned out. And we know that the light of Christ will never burn out, because He's the light of the world. Amen. Amen. And Christ lives in us. Amen. Christ is trying to show us that, remember when He said when he leaves, He's not going to leave us alone. That He was going to send the Helper, the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is the Spirit of God. The Spirit is within each and every one of us. Amen. It tells us in Isaiah, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me. Amen. You have to believe that, though. You truly have to believe that you have the Spirit of the living God in you, that you are one with Christ, and being one with Christ, you're one with the Lord, Amen. Our Heavenly Father. Amen. And that if God is for us, nobody could be against us. Amen? That's just how it is, church. But you have to believe it. Because if you don't believe it, then it's you're not going to reap the benefits. You're not going to have the covering. You'll be saved. You know what I mean? You'll be saved, but you're not going to have a better relationship with God, a closer one. You're not going to have the sanctification that you need in order to be the light of the world, in order to not lash out at the driver that's cut you off, to not lash out
when your wife burns the food, or to not lash out when the kids don't throw the trash. You know what I mean? You gotta have grace. We gotta have grace with everyone the same way Christ. God teaches me little small lessons every day. And it could be with my employees or anybody else. They're of the world. You know what I mean? They don't have the mindset and the mentality like we do. They're not close to God like we are. So we have higher expectations, you know what I mean? We cannot put those standards and expectations on everybody else. We just can't. Because then we become judgmental. And we think we're holier than thou when we're not. We have to have the same grace that God has with us. Amen. It says if you're going to judge somebody, you're going to be judged for the same thing. As a matter of fact, it says don't ever come to the altar if you have an offense in your heart. If you have unforgiveness in your heart, if you come to this altar and you ask God for something, he's not going to hear you. Because you have to go first forgive whoever, you know, offended you or did something wrong to you. That's just how it works. Amen. And then we have the brass altar. Like brother said, we have to wash. So that's what's so important about coming to church. Anytime this door is open, because we know we fall short every day, and we get tainted, we get contaminated by the world, and it's filth. To God, it's like a filthy rag. When we come to this altar, we look like filthy rags. But thank God we have Jesus to come through as our mediator, to come to the foot of the cross and lay it down. Amen. On a daily, it's not like we're asking for forgiveness over and over and over again, like some people think. Some people got in their head like, I'm out of control. I'm never gonna get this right. I'm just a sinner, and I'm never gonna get this right. You know, and it's not. What we come to here when we come to the wash basin, it's just to come clean. To come clean before God. So that way when we come to him, all he sees is his son, Jesus. And when he sees his son, Jesus, everything you did throughout the day or throughout the week, he doesn't even know about. Because Jesus has already, you already brought it to the feet of Jesus. Jesus already forgave you, and he's your mediator between man and God. So that's how that works. That's the process. Amen? So we have to know that process in order to truly understand that God isn't some God up there that's just wanting to reprimand, that just wants to crack the whip on us, and he's like, I don't know, he's like somebody that we can't talk to, you know what I mean? Because I know, like, with me and my son, sometimes I'm really harsh on him. And, like, he feels sometimes that he can't talk to me because I'm so blunt with him, because I know when he's manipulating me. I know when he's trying to get over on me, and I don't allow that. And I tell my wife not to allow it either, but she's like, honey, you gotta have grace. You gotta just you gotta pick your battles, so to speak, sometimes, you know what I mean? And it's the same way with God. The same way. He knows already. He knows when we're coming to him with not the right intentions. You know what I'm saying? When we're not being true, when we're not being honest, when we're not truly laying it down, when we're just speaking vain words, when we're just, you know, crying out, you know, when we're just lashing out. But if we were to just be honest with God, he'll receive us with open arms no matter what. Amen. And he'll help us. He'll give us the strength and the will and the desire to see the sin and the shame and everything it is that brings us down and gets us angry for what it is. And then that's where the wisdom comes in. When you have that wisdom and that knowledge, it gives you power over those small things. It's so small. You don't realize it, church, but little things. When you're a Christian, it's the smallest things that set you up, that set you off. And then when you realize it, you're like, wow, did I really just get upset over something so stupid, something so small? Did I really allow this, my pride to puff up so big to make, you know, that person feel so little for something small? It's just crazy how sometimes we react and do things when it's out of a natural reaction, because that's our old self, our old nature. And we allow it to come out instead of, you know, taking that thought into captivity or being, or just being the bigger and better person. You know what I mean? Yeah, We have to continue to fill this with oil. If this has no oil, it's like the 10 virgins, like Pastor said, but they didn't have no oil. They tried to borrow it from somebody else, and they didn't want to give it. They didn't. So what happened? Their light went out, and they were in darkness. And then everything just took root, and it went deep down. And then they had a heart issue. And then they got numb, and they gave in to the world. They gave up. That's what it was. That's how it is. But we can't give up, church. As long as we got oil, we don't have to give up, because we have hope. We have light. We have direction. Amen? It said his word is a lamp to our feet. It gives us that guidance and the direction that we need, church. Amen? So we have to stay in his word. We have to stay in the church in order to keep our lamps full, in order to keep that flame burning. This thing was 5.5 feet tall. 5.5 feet tall. And those bases, these things, we're talking about a holy place that was 90 feet by 30 feet and 30 feet high of solid gold on the inside. In order to light a room that big, this thing had flames coming out of it. Just imagine how much oil it took to keep those flames burning day and night. It's a representation of God's light that is, you can't quench it. It says that he sent us out into the world, the light into the world, and the darkness will not overcome it, right? And he was speaking about the light in us, that the darkness, the world, will not overcome it as long as we stay in the light, as long as we stay in the church, as long as we stay planted, grounded, and rooted. He's always going to make a way out for us, church. He's always going to give us the support we need through our brothers and sisters in Christ, and he's always going to make sure the provisions are there. No matter when times are good or when times are bad, we have to stay firm and stay planted and be faithful. And then we had the labor, which Pastor preached on. The labor, which was, let's see, which one was the labor? Yeah, the labor was the wash basin. We just touched on that one. And now we're going to get into the lampstand. So we don't have too much time, so I might not be able to get through it all. So if you guys can just bear with me, I'm going to get through it. I don't like really paraphrasing on somebody else's writings, but I did go through this book, and I cross-referenced with all the scriptures and with the knowledge that I have in God, and it lines up. And you guys should do the same. You should never take any book's word for it, any man's word for anything. You always got to cross-reference with the word of God. And just like sitting in here with all the scriptures and everything, you should be writing down scriptures. You should be writing down scriptures so that way you can go meditate on it for yourself. So that way you can get the bigger picture, because I'm only paraphrasing. I'm only giving you bits and pieces of what's going on. But if you read about in I think it's in Exodus 25 where God gave Moses the plans for the tabernacle, it'll all make sense to you, because now you have a different perspective. They're not just objects anymore. They have meaning to them. They have significance. They have power. Amen? Because symbols are just symbols, right? But when you give them significance, when you give them meaning, that's what gives them their power. Amen? The Egyptians knew this. Everything they did was all symbolic. It was all symbolic, and that's where they got their power from, but their power wasn't from our God. It was from dark gods. Amen? So they had soothsayers. They would try to mimic everything God did, but it didn't prevail in the end. And God had the last word. Amen? Amen. God's always going to have the last word, especially when it comes to stubborn people. Amen? And Pharaoh was the most stubborn of them all. Amen? All right, I'm just gonna read, and then you guys just kind of follow along with me, okay? So I've already kind of went over the lampstand, and it's going to kind of repeat a little bit of what I said, because I just, you know me, I just, once I know something, I got to, you know, kind of give you a different perspective to kind of, you know, give you some foundation. It says, reviewing the picture of the tabernacle so far, we have been at the altar, the cross, and Yeshua's blood. Then we went to the laver, the brass bowl with the water of the Holy Spirit for cleansing. We found out there is cleansing on a daily basis in addition to the blood of the cross, which is a one-time justification matter. That's our half shekel. Amen. But remember, the laver is for sanctification. We are justified at the altar of our sins, at the altar, and our sins are gone. We have washed daily at the laver for cleansing, and now we are becoming sanctified. These two things to prepare us for what is yet to come. Amen. The God who was and is to come. And what's to come? Jesus. Amen. Everything always points to Jesus, church. It's always about Jesus. If it ain't about Jesus, don't even pay attention to it. Amen. Because he's the light of the world, and he has the answer to everything. Amen. He has your future in his hand. God didn't come and save us from our sin and then sanctify us and change us into his image for our own pleasure and enjoyment. It's not about us, church. It's not. When you come to this church, when you offer your life to the Lord, he tells you plainly. He doesn't want your sacrifices. He doesn't want your money. He doesn't want anything. He wants your life. And it's a living sacrifice. And I know it sounds kind of crazy, because back in the day when they sacrificed those animals, it was a blood sacrifice, and they killed it. And they wiped their blood all over the altar, and it was gruesome. But you have to have a deeper understanding to understand why that's the way it was. And that's what we're doing now. We're trying to lay a foundation to give you an understanding on why Jesus had to die for our sins. Amen. And it's the same thing for us. If he died for us, and now we have eternal life with him, but now this life on this earth isn't about us anymore. We gave this life up here on earth to have eternal life in heaven. Amen. But as long as we're still here, we have a divine purpose. We have a calling. We have work to do, church. Amen. But there's benefits doing that work. There's still life. There's still joy. There's still peace. There's still harmony. There's still love. There's still family. There's still everything that the world wants. But they're chasing it. As a Christian, as a blessed Christian, as a blessed man or woman of God, the blessings will come to you. Everything will follow you. You don't have to chase it, because the Word of God tells us clearly to seek ye first the kingdom of God, right? And that all things will be added unto us. Amen. Yes, amen. You know that, sis. And you got to keep that. Did you hear that scripture? Matthew 6:33. Make that your foundational scripture. I promise you, it's true. And as long as you read that on a daily and ingrain it into your heart and believe it, you'll receive it. Amen. And you'll know, you'll truly understand the kingdom of God here on earth as in heaven. Amen. It says he justified us and sanctified us for a reason. And this reason is not in the outer court, meaning the world. Amen. The two pieces of furniture are in the outer court to get you ready to go into the holy place. We are going to open this curtain and go into the holy place. Like I said, it's 30 feet long, 15 feet wide, and 15 feet tall. It's twice the size of the Holy of Holies. The holy place is 2/3 of the tent. The back 1/3 would be the Holy of Holies. The Kadosh, Kadoshim. So the question is, what's so significant about going through that curtain? Say that again, sis.
Separating yourself for the Lord.
Amen. So once we have our sacrifice, we wash ourselves, and then we go into the holy place. And what three objects were in the holy place? You have the menorah, right? Which is the light. Then you have the table of showbread and the altar of incense. Okay? So the table of showbread is our sustenance. The light, it separates us from the darkness. Amen? It gives us hope. It gives us direction. It gives us light. And then you have the altar of incense, which represents our ministry. Amen? So you just got to pay attention, because this all goes hand in hand. It's all in sequence for a reason, because you cannot operate in ministry until you have came with your sacrifice, which is us giving ourselves to God, washing ourselves before we enter to the holy place, because God is a holy God. We come to Jesus, the light of the world. He gives us our sustenance, the table of showbread, and everything we need to accomplish the ministry that he has bestowed into each and every one of our hearts. Individually as well as collectively as a church. Amen? Is it, you guys understand that? Does that make sense? Praise God. Hallelujah. It says, we're going to find out that the holy place represents the church. Amen? Right where you're at. You're in the right place. Turn to your neighbor and say, you're right where God wants you. Amen. Hallelujah. It says, so this is what happens. Look, I just said it, but it's going to say it again. It says you get cleansed, right? But the whole, in the wash basin, then you get saved, you get born again, and then you get sanctified. And then you have the church life. Amen. You see that? See how it goes? This is the process, church. Everything that we've been taught, everything we went through as kids, when we came to church, we gave our life to God, we got baptized, you know, with the water, and then we came to know Jesus, and then we got involved with the ministry. We didn't even know anything about this, but it was happening according to God's plan, because that's how good He is. And now He's just given us revelation to know that everything we did was not in vain, that it was with divine purpose, that God orchestrated it the whole way. Amen? But now He's revealing Himself to us. Amen? Now He's given us divine revelation so that way we can have relationship with Him. Amen? Through Jesus. Amen? One day we will have direct conversation with the Lord. I promise you that. But right now, we live in this body. We have sin. So we cannot go into that Holy of Holies unless we go through the process of the washing, of the light, the sustenance, and the altar of the incense. Amen? It's a process. And as long as we obey that process, we're going to be all right, church. We're going to be good. Amen. Thank you, Lord. You get cleansed, and then you have the church life. It says you come to a place where it's time to minister. Say, it's time to minister. It's time to minister. If God can use me, He can use anyone, church. I promise you. I knew beyond the shadow of a doubt, even as a child, that I was different. And I say that not to mean that I'm different, like better than anyone, but I promise you, growing up as a kid, I always felt like I knew more than a lot of people. I just had that common sense. I didn't have a childhood like everybody else. I grew up with nothing but, I hung out with nothing but older people. But there was a reason for it, because God had a calling on my life. And I didn't know it then, but I know it now. Because even as a child, I knew God. And I didn't know Him through somebody teaching me. I knew Him through creation. I was always in awe of creation and everything around me. Anything that I got to experience as a kid for the first time, I was so excited. I just knew that there had to be a God, and I knew that one day I was going to meet Him. Amen. I didn't know how, I didn't know where, I didn't know who was going to introduce me to Him, but I knew that I was going to meet Him. And like, why? How? Why would that be in my heart? Why would that? And even when I was in trouble, like, I didn't have a dad, I didn't have no guidance, I didn't have no discipline, and I had to go through the whole juvenile system, the group homes, the penitentiaries, everything. But even through those struggles, God was with me, and I held on to my faith, and I knew, and I never ever doubted God, I never ever blamed God, and I never ever denied my faith, no matter what I was going through at the time, or went through, or how I was abandoned and forsaken by everybody that, you know, I loved, everybody I looked up to, everybody that I thought was leading me in the right direction, but they weren't. Everything they taught me was based on lies and preconceived notions. And until I got into the Word of God for myself, that's when I began to understand. That's when I knew for a fact that I was a child of God. And I read in His Word that when the parents leave the child, that God becomes your parent. Amen. So when I read that, from that day forward, I always addressed Him as Heavenly Father, my daddy. He was my father. He was my protector. He was my shield and my buckler, my everything. And I always prayed, and I always read my Word, no matter what. And even though I fell short and had to go through every prison and the whole system, God still kept me. And he brought me out even stronger. But he brought me out with his word in my heart. Amen. Written on the table of my heart. Amen. I wasn't taught by man. I wasn't taught by any school or nothing. It's just ingrained in my heart. Like, I know my Bible like the back of my hand, and I've read it over and over and over again. And it was for a reason. It was for a purpose, is what this book says, church. And that same purpose, I believe, is the same purpose and the same reason why each and every one of you are here. Not the whole church. Not the whole church isn't here coming to these studies every week. It's just you guys. Amen. Because God has something special for each and every one of you guys. Because you guys are going to play a part in this fivefold ministry. One of you are going to be a minister. One of you are going to be an evangelist. One of you are going to be a teacher. One of you are going to be a prophet. One of you are going to be a healer. We all are going to play a part in this ministry, and it's going to operate the way God wants it to operate, church. Amen. And I'm not just saying that. I believe that with my whole heart, church. But we have to have order in the church. Our heart has to be in it. We have to truly believe it, and our heart has to be in it. And we can't. We can't. And I know pastor's just one man, and we can't expect him to do everything. You know what I mean? We can't expect pastor to operate this whole ministry. One man can't operate a whole church. The church has to function collectively. We all have individual gifts, but we have to function collectively. And that starts with being obedient to your pastor. Even when, you know, sometimes he says things you don't agree with, or if he offends you, you know, you have to communicate. Like, you can ask pastor. When he offends me, I talk to him personally. I don't talk to everybody else. Did you hear what pastor said? This, that, and the other. I go directly to him because I'm a man and he's a man. And men make mistakes. We all make mistakes and we all fall short, but you cannot judge somebody based on the mistakes. Yeah, he's anointed and appointed by God, and we have to give him that respect regardless. Amen. Honor and respect. Yes, sis. No matter what. I don't like reading from books. I had my own message already set up, but because my pastor said he wanted to go through this book, I said, all right, we're going to do it. And praise God that we did, because we're learning so much from it. Amen. And I'll tell you right now that my teaching was about foundation. Was about foundation. Before he even brought this book out, my teaching was about foundation. But it wasn't about foundation based on Yeshua's blood. This was foundation based on Christians without foundation. Amen. Because Christians without foundation have no ministry. Amen. Jesus Christ is the chief cornerstone. Amen. And we have to build upon that foundation in order for it to work. Amen. That's why Christ is in the center of it all. Amen. And we branch out from him. We're grafted in. And as long as we're grafted in to this light, we will never be in darkness. We will always have hope, and we will always have a way out. Amen. We will always have provision, and we will always have a ministry and a purpose here on earth. Amen. Until we get to heaven. Praise God. Thank you, Lord. It says, this did not happen in the outer courts for your own pleasure. You didn't get born again for your own sake. As a born again new covenant believer, you are a new covenant priest and a new covenant king. And this is going to take place inside the holy place. This is where you are going to come and be good for something. You're going to be of service to something. God is going to be able to use you. Amen. What an honor, church. Seriously, like, I signed up for the army, and I got denied because I was such a troublemaker, and I was in so much trouble as a kid. I wanted to try to redeem myself. I wanted to try to make up for it and serve a purpose, to do something better with my life, you know? And what better? I remember reading a scripture in the Word. It says, there is no greater love than for one to lay down one's life for a friend. Amen. So I thought that by me going to joining the army to lay my life down for my country and for my family, that it was going to make up for everything. But God had something different in store for me. Amen. Just like he has in store for you. Amen. Because this country is no longer on that foundation. It's sad to say, but it's not. It's not we the people, by the people, for the people. There's so many rich people that have no God in their lives that are puppeteers and they control everything. And that's just the facts, church. Everything that we know, that we think we know about politics and government and everything else, is all a facade. It's all misinformation, misdirection, and it's a laughingstock. That's how sickening it is. And they think we're not paying attention. And they're like, oh, well, why don't you vote? Why don't you get involved? Why don't you do this? It's like, how am I going to vote for somebody that I don't know? I don't know his lifestyle. I don't know where he lives. I don't know how he treats his kid. I don't know what church he goes to. I don't know this. And they don't give you that information. They give you a bunch of false information on the TVs and a bunch of pamphlets and try to give you the background of somebody, and they make them look like they're pillars of light. But how many of you know they're wolves in sheep's clothing? Amen? They're wolves in sheep's clothing. And not all of them. There are a lot of good men and women out there that are in politics, that are in places of power because God put them there. And one day soon, the men and women that are going to be in places of power are going to be men and women of God who are accountable, like you and I. Righteous men and women of God that will not falter, that will not be bribed, that cannot be bought. Just like in the story of Balaam and Balak, he said, even if you give me half of your kingdom, I cannot do what you're asking me to do, because no man can curse what God has blessed. Amen. Amen? So you have to know you're blessed, church. You have to know that God has you right where he needs you to be, and that he's preparing us. This little tiny church he's preparing us. Amen. For greatness. Amen. For something special, for something greater than us. It's not about us, church. It's about his plan and his purpose to save the world. Amen? To save the world, literally the world, church. And that you might think, it's just like, I'm just one man, I'm just one woman. You have to read history. There's so many one-man armies in our world history books. It's unbelievable. But it's because they had faith. It's because they believed. It's because they didn't waver. They didn't falter. It's because they knew the God they served. They knew that if it was their time, it was their time. And it was because God had their number. Amen? And he wanted them to go. But if it's not your time, you're going to stay here and you're going to do great things for God. Amen? Even in the face of adversity. Even in the face of death. You can't. It tells you in Job, when the devil wanted to tempt Job, right? He said, you could do anything you want to him. Just don't take his life. He didn't have permission to take Job's life. And who came out victorious at the end of that one? It was Job, right? Because not only, I believe, did his family get saved and go to heaven, but God restored everything that he lost twofold and gave it all back. And that's not even what it was about. It was just about a man of faith that didn't curse God, that didn't give up, that stood firm because he knew God. He had a relationship with God. And how are we going to have that kind of relationship with God if we don't know God personally? If we don't know where to meet God or where to go? And God is trying to tell us it's right here in the church with Jesus as the chief corner, with Jesus as the center of it all, the light. He's not here with us now. It's the Holy Spirit. But one day soon, Jesus will be here with us. But he's preparing our hearts. He's filling he's pruning our wicks. Amen. And filling our oil. And that oil, when he comes back, we're going to be like those 10 virgins with our oil full. And it represents the bride. Amen. The church is the bride. We are the bride of Christ. Amen. The first fruits of his labor. Amen. And he's going to take us to his glory and show us the mansions and the kingdoms and the new world that he has prepared for us. Amen. Amen. It's really when you think about it, it's amazing. It really is. Every time I think about it and I envision it, I'm just in awe and I'm just like, wow, God, for real. And I think about it, I dream about it, you know, I contemplate on it, and I go over and it over and over into my head, and I pray about it, and I tell God, just like Ezekiel, just show me. Show me, Lord, show me your glory. Like Ezekiel gave him dreams and visions. But now it's in my heart. Now I'm seeking it out. It says if you want to know God, and you have to seek him out. You have to seek him like if you're looking for a hidden treasure. And those that seek will find. That's what the word of God says. Are you seeking, church? Are you looking for God? Amen. I don't know about you, but I am. I'm looking for the light. Amen. It says to follow the light. Amen. Hallelujah. It says God is going to be able to use you. We have the table of showbread for our sustenance. Amen. We have the altar of incense for our ministry to God. And we have the menorah. Three pieces of furniture in the holy place. As you walk in, the menorah would be on your left. The table of showbread would be on your right. The altar of incense, right in the middle, in front of the curtain of the Holy of Holies. This is where we are, church. The front door, made of blue, purple, scarlet, and fine linen. The part you could see from the outside would be pomegranates, palm trees, and pretty flowers embroidered on the outside. Blue is the primary color with the white linen, and it has scarlet and purple and lots of fancy embroidery on it. The room itself is made of 10 curtains, all attached by hooks and clasps. The 10 curtains represents the believers all being joined together, built together in a holy habitation. As you see this church forming, you can remember that we are attached and held together. The church life is not an independent matter. If you know somebody that's off on their own, they never come to church and they tell you, I'm just with God on my own. You have to wonder about them. We are to build together into a holy habitation, and it's scripturally sound to say you are in fellowship one with another and are built up together, and that we need to be in relationship within the church body. The tabernacle portrays this idea. It's so true, church. Everything lines up. Everything fits perfectly when you think about it. And each and every one of us has a part to play in that. Each and every one of us are a part of the foundation, the pillars. We might just be a small church, but we're going to be pillars of a nation. Amen. God is going to do something so wonderful in this church, and it's going to start with this church. And the love that comes from this church is going to reverberate all across the world. Amen. Because that's how love works. We're ambassadors of love. And love never fails. Love conquers a multitude of sins. Love is key. Amen. So next time you're feeling down and out, and next time somebody gets under your skin, next time you feel like giving up or taking that hit or one drink or whatever it is, whatever your small little sin or the thing that you have think you have no control of, just remember that God is love, and that love never fails, and that he loves you regardless, and that you don't have to stay away, and you don't have to feel ashamed. Even in your weakness, you can be strong, but you need to come and wash. You need to come to the altar. You need to come and prepare yourself to enter into that holy place, so that way you can see the light, so that way you can have your sustenance, so that way God can prepare you for your ministry. Amen, because that's what he's doing right now, church. He's preparing each and every one of us for our ministry. Brother Nick went with me for a street ministry the other day, and I got him to pray. It was awesome. Amen. It was, because he, everybody thinks that, you know, they can't do things, or they don't want to do things, or they feel like they're not going to do it right. There is no right way to do ministry. There's only God's way, church. Amen. And God is showing us how to do it together, collectively as a body. Yes. Amen. And the only way that we can do things his way is to keep Jesus at the center of it all. To allow his light to be our light, so that way we can reflect his glory in all that we say and do. Amen. We got so much more to go through, and I'm not going to be able to get through it, so I'm going to close with that. But I just want you guys to know that Jesus loves you. He's the light of the world. He'll never leave you nor forsake you. That you are a part of this church. You have a purpose in your life, and that we're going to do great things together. Amen. We're going to make this thing work. We're gonna It looks like this church is small, but I promise you it's going to grow.
Amen.
And it's going to grow, and I'm going to tell you why it's going to grow. Because the people in this church are authentic. The people in this church truly do love God with all their hearts. They don't come to church just to come to church. They don't do ministry just to do ministry. Everybody here is voluntary. We're not looking for any pay, any rewards for the things we do. We just want to honor God. Amen. We just want to please God. And if God wants to bless us, then so be it.
Yes.
We'll accept it. Amen? Because I always pray, God don't. It just like Solomon, one of the kings, where he says, don't make me a rich man, because I don't wanna not have to depend on you. I don't wanna feel like I have it all and don't need anything else. Just keep me content. Just give me the things I need. If you're gonna bless me to be a blessing to others. Amen. And that's my prayer for the church. Bless us all so we can be a blessing to others. Because there's just something that happens that takes place in the heart of a man and a woman that has something to offer, to give, to help in a present time of need. And that's truly what the church is supposed to be, is a present help in time of need. And that's on our blueprints of our pamphlets, to reach the lost at any cost and to meet the need that needs to be met. Amen. So if there's a need in this church, in the body especially, the household of faith, if there's a need that needs to be met, let it be known. If you need help in your ministry, or if there's something on your heart, on your mind, talk to a brother or a sister so we can disciple you, so we can get you the material you need, so we can do whatever we got to do to help you in that ministry, so that way you don't feel alone or left out. Because there's so many people that have come into this ministry that have felt left out and alone because they didn't feel like they fit in. We all fit in this church. You guys all have a place in this church. That's your seat right there, sister. And nobody else can have it. Right on. Amen. I'm going to pray us out. Father God, I just thank you so much for your word, Lord God, for the revelation, Lord God, of the tabernacle, Lord God. We thank you, Lord God, for the menorah, Lord God, Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior, the light of the world, Lord God. Without him, we would be nothing, Lord. We just thank you, Lord God, for the table of showbread, for our sustenance. We thank you, Lord God, for the brazen altar, Lord God, to where we can come and offer our sacrifice, Lord God, a living sacrifice, Lord God, of all that we have and all that we are, Lord God. We thank you for the brass altar where we can come and wash, Lord God, and be made clean, Lord God, before we enter the Holy of Holies, Lord God. A place where we can leave all the shame, Lord God, and not have to pick it back up, Lord God. I thank you, Lord God, that when we enter the Holy of Holies, Lord God, that we can see your light, Lord God. That we have hope, Lord God. That we have direction, Lord God. And that we have a present help in time of need, Lord God. I just pray, Lord God, that you would continue to guide us, to teach us through your word, Lord God, to give us revelation in due season, Lord God, to bless our finances, Lord God, bless this church, Lord God, this ministry, Lord God. I pray, Lord God, that the offer that's on the table, Lord God, will stay standing until we have the money we need to buy this place, Lord God, so that way we can knock down these walls, Lord God, and open up these doors for a children's ministry, Lord God, for the youth ministry, Lord God, for the infants ministry, Lord God. And I pray, Lord God, that one day we might even have a men's home and a women's home, Lord God. There's so much more that we can do, Lord God. We just need your provision, my God. We need your blessing, Lord God. And I know, Lord God, that all you have to do is give the word, Lord God, and so shall it be. For your word says, as it is written, so shall it be, Lord God. So we're going to come in agreement, Lord God, collectively as a body, as your church, this ecclesia, Lord God, in agreement, Lord God. And we want to thank you, Lord God, in advance for all the prayers that are going to be answered today. Amen, Lord God. Thank you. Hallelujah. Oh, we're going to come and pray before we go. Father God, we just thank you, Lord God.
Thank you, Lord God, that you're so gracious, Lord God.
That you love us so much, Lord God. We thank you for the light of the world, Lord God. And we just pray, Lord God, that you would cause your face and countenance to shine upon us, Lord. So we can be the light of the world, Lord God. A light that does not be hidden underneath the carpet, Lord God, but a light that's set on top of the mountain for all to see, Lord God. I pray, Lord God, that you would just saturate us in your love, Lord God, before we leave this place, Lord God, that everything that we were taught today, Lord God, that it would be ingrained, Lord God, on the table of our heart, Lord God, and that we would take your love with us, Lord God, out into the world, Lord God. That everything that we were taught today, Lord God, that we would go teach somebody else and show them, Lord God, what we learned, Lord God, and give them revelation, Lord God, and speak of your truth, Lord God, and begin to educate, Lord God, your people, Lord God, the people you love, Lord God, who are out there, Lord, in the midst of darkness, Lord God, who need your light, Lord God. I pray, Lord God, that you would fill our lamps, Lord God. Fill us with your oil, Lord God. Anoint each and every one of us, Lord God, and give us the strength and the courage, Lord God, to go out there and speak truth, Lord God, into the lives of your people, Lord God, to uplift them, Lord God, and encourage them, Lord God, to come back, Lord God, to the altar, Lord God, so that way they can be washed, Lord God, and be whole, Lord God, and receive forgiveness, Lord God, and have love, Lord God, and hope and peace in their life, Lord God, to where they can enter into your rest, Lord God, and not have to worry, Lord God, and not have to bear the weight of the world on their own, Lord God. There's so much more that we have here in this church, Lord God, that is offered freely, Lord God. It says it's a gift, Lord God, and a gift that you give freely, Lord God, and we just want to thank you, Lord, for our salvation. We want to thank you for this ministry, Lord God. We thank you for your provisions and your strength, Lord God. We thank you, Lord, for our families, our friends, and loved ones, Lord. We thank you, Lord God, for the very breath that we have in our hearts, Lord God. And we just pray, Lord God, that with every breath that we have, Lord God, and every waking moment, Lord God, that we would wake up with purpose, Lord God, in our lives, Lord God, that we would know, Lord God, that it's not by mistake, Lord, or coincidence or chance, Lord God, that we're here to serve a purpose, Lord God, and that we're here to prosper in this ministry, Lord God, and to be a beacon of hope, Lord God, to those who are lost in darkness, Lord. I thank you, Lord God. I thank you, Lord God. I thank you, my God. Hallelujah.